Thank you very much, Joanna. And we'll move on to topical questions now. And at question number one, I call Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it's given to women and children who are caught up in the war in Ukraine.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Gillian Martin for her question on this International Women's Day. Our thoughts, support and solidarity go to the women and girls of Ukraine who have shown unimaginable strength since Russia's invasion of their country. It is appalling to witness women and children fleeing their homes from war and violence, and our thoughts are with all the people of Ukraine, and we stand ready to welcome them to make Scotland a home. As well as medical supplies, we are providing £4 million of humanitarian assistance for Ukraine, including £1 million for UNICEF. This funding will help to support women and children in Ukraine and neighbouring countries.
Gillian Martin.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Over the last week, we've all seen over 2 million refugees, the majority of which are women and children fleeing war in Ukraine. And I just heard that the Home Secretary, Priti Patel, wasn't present to answer an urgent question on visa requirements and letting refugees in Westminster just now. Given the support we've seen across Europe, though, does the Minister think the UK Government must step up and introduce a comprehensive settlement scheme as soon as possible, and help those people who are much in need of support and a home, like he just said in his last answer?
Minister.
Yes, absolutely. The Scottish Government and Scotland's local authorities have made clear to the UK Government that they stand ready to offer refuge and sanctuary where necessary for those who may be displaced. The UK Government's current proposals are insufficient, and the Scottish Government continues to urgently call on the UK Government to act now and develop a comprehensive resettlement programme. It's vital that rapid, safe and legal routes are established immediately. I'm also extremely concerned at the mixed messages being sent out to people desperate to navigate their way through the complex bureaucratic systems to reach the UK. And this is a message that has also been made clear by MPs across the chamber, direct to the Home Office ministers in the last hour. And I also note reports suggesting that the UK visa centre being opened for Ukrainian refugees currently present in Calais may actually be opened 70 miles away in Lille. That just exemplifies the tone-deaf, totally inadequate response from the UK Government regarding Ukrainian refugees.
Gillian Martin.
I thank the Minister for that answer, as depressing as some of that information is. This International Women's Day, women across the globe are fighting for equality. And we need to mention the many brave women in Russia who have been protesting Putin's illegal invasion of Ukraine. It's unlikely they'll see anything from the West as the regime shuts down internet sites they don't like. But those words of solidarity do matter if they get through. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what message the Scottish Government has for those brave Russian women and girls protesting the regime and caught up in the violence that they are been subjected to when they protest?
Minister.
Gillian Martin is absolutely right. It's devastating and shocking to see 2 million people from Ukraine, the majority of whom are women and children, having to flee their country from war and violence. On International Women's Day, which is meant to be a day that governments demonstrate their commitment to making our world a safer, more equal world for women and girls, we can see that Putin has no respect for the lives of anyone. So I can only applaud the brave women in Russia who have been protesting against Putin's barbaric invasion and say to them very clearly, our issue is with Putin and his regime, and we know these barbaric acts are not in your name.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This morning, the Polish Embassy to the UK put out a statement expressing gratitude to UK citizens and organisations who had contributed aid to the Ukraine crisis. But they also asked that those wishing to help not to organise further collections of in-kind donations due to the time and effort it takes to distribute such help, and instead asked that people organise fundraisers and directed donations to verified organisations to use these funds in accordance with the strict needs of those affected and the effective operation in the long term. Can I ask the Minister what work is the Scottish Government doing to ensure this message gets across, whilst not diminishing the generosity and compassion of Scots who have come together over the last few weeks to give aid and assistance in whatever way they can?
Minister.
Donald Cameron is absolutely right that we absolutely applaud once again the generosity in kind and in spirit of the people of Scotland who are looking to, in practical, in financial and gift and aid terms, are looking to do everything that they can to support the people in Ukraine who are suffering the horrors of war. The Scottish Government has been working actively and with much vigour over the last few days to try to make sure that we are supporting aid getting to Ukraine in the best possible way, and we would encourage people to support the financial appeals that have been made, particularly through the Disasters Emergency Committee, to ensure that that aid gets effectively and quickly to where it is needed. Once again, we thank the people of Scotland for their generosity in that front too. Over £10 million has been raised there, and I ask them to continue in that generosity of spirit going forward.
Co-Cap Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Alongside the harrowing images of families fleeing their homes, we have heard reports of black and minority ethnic Ukrainian refugees being denied exit from Ukraine or being subjected to different treatment. I am sure that we can all agree that no one fleeing conflict should have to face inhumane and unnecessary hurdles when seeking refuge. Can I therefore ask the Minister, to what extent has the experience of Glasgow in welcoming and integrating refugees and asylum seekers influenced its approach to the Ukrainian crisis?
Minister.
Thank Co-Cap Stewart for that question, and she's absolutely right. Scotland has a long history of welcoming people of all nationalities and faiths, including those seeking refuge and asylum from war and terror elsewhere. We are committed to supporting their integration into our communities and providing safety and security they need to begin to rebuild their lives. Scotland stands ready to offer refuge and sanctuary for those who may be displaced, as we did with the Syrian resettlement programme, which saw all 32 local authorities in Scotland participate and welcome over 3,300 refugees into their communities. We must ensure that we learn the lessons from this programme and the Afghanistan resettlement schemes in order to provide rapid and appropriate support to those who need it fleeing from Ukraine.
Sarah Boyack.
Oh, it says red. It is working. Can I thank the Minister for that answer and ask, in terms of support for local organisations working with our councils, what preparation work is actually being done at the moment in the hope that we will be able to support those people who are fleeing from Ukraine, particularly the women and children?
Minister.
Yeah, thank you to Sarah Boyack for that question. Yeah, the conversations with COSLA are active, both from this ministerial portfolio. The Cabinet Secretary has been in discussions a lot, as has the Cabinet Secretary for Social Security and Social Justice. It has also been in discussions with COSLA to ensure that we are ready to welcome the Ukrainian refugees coming to Scotland when they're able to get here, when the bureaucracy and the intransigence of the UK Government is finally overcome and we have a situation that allows the people fleeing the horrors of war in Ukraine to come here and make Scotland their home.
Question number two, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will review its position on North Sea oil and gas exploration and production in relation to the security of Scotland's energy supply.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
The Scottish Government has been clear that unlimited extraction of fossil fuels is not consistent with their climate obligations. Scotland's energy sector has a crucial role to play as Europe and the world moves beyond the age of fossil fuels, and we can be a key part of a solution that seeks to ensure energy security amid ongoing economic and geopolitical turbulence. At the Scottish Renewables Conference today, I made the point that renewable power could provide a more consistent and stable form of energy supply in wake of rising prices and unpredictable supplies of oil and gas. Scotland has among the richest renewable energy production potential in the whole of Europe, but it is unfairly penalised when it comes to transmission charges applied, given a direct disincentive to producers and investors. Their focus is now on achieving the fastest possible just transition for the oil and gas sector, one that delivers jobs and economic benefit, ensures an energy security and meets the climate obligations.
Liam Kerr.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, which I think boils down to that the Scottish Government will not be reviewing its position. And people will hope that before concluding that security of supply, environmental benefit and ensuring we cut off funding to Russia are not reasons enough to pursue domestic oil and gas, a full investigation into future energy security was carried out. So, following his ramping up of renewables, in what year Does the Cabinet Secretary's research project that renewables will consistently cover 100% of Scotland's energy without ever needing oil and gas? And when does his research say Scotland will have no further need for imported oil and gas?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sure the member will recognise that Scotland and the UK as a whole has a security of energy supply as it stands at the present moment. It has a very low reliance on importing oil and gas from Russia, around apparently about 2%, which could easily be displaced by alternative routes. So I think it would be wrong for the member to try and give the impression there's an issue around security of supply. And as he'll also be aware, we are at the point where we have an equivalent of Scotland's domestic electricity supply, some 98% of it now coming from renewable sources. We've been ramping that up over recent years, and we plan to ramp that up yet further. The outcome from the ScotWind leasing round just demonstrates the scale of ambition that there is to invest in Scotland's renewable sector, which could have a massive, not only environmental, but economic boost to Scotland. Not just in renewable energy, but also in hydrogen power, which we make as not only the provision of hydrogen for our own domestic uses, but also as a net exporter to other parts of Europe. So Scotland is well placed in its energy transition, and the policies and approach that this government is taking will make sure that we continue to drive that forward in the years to come.
William Kerr.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but many others take a very different view from the Cabinet Secretary. The UK government has been clear that we must ramp up domestic gas production to replace Russian supplies and reduce costs on UK families. Since Sunday, Messrs Blackford and Smith MP and Ewing MSP have also demanded more homegrown gas for security of supply, not least because, as Ian Blackford put it, buying Russian energy funds Putin's war. An unnamed SNP minister said in the weekend's papers, "What's puzzling to many is when you have a domestic supply, why you wouldn't want to use that for the benefit of people here and to stop paying for supply from elsewhere, particularly if it benefits Russians." So what evidence does the Cabinet Secretary have that convinces him that in rejecting more domestic production, he and Nicola Sturgeon are right and everybody else is wrong?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I think the member fundamentally misses the point, and that is that the climate crisis which we face has not gone away. You only have to look at the report that came from the IPCC just the other week there, where it set out very clearly the scale and nature of the climate challenge which we face and the need to make sure that we take appropriate action to deal with that. But the answer to the member's question is to step up the decarbonisation of our energy systems, just in the way in which Germany are proposing to do it by bringing forward a target by some 15 years, just by the way in which the Dutch Prime Minister set out yesterday when he was in London, sharing a platform with Boris Johnson. The answer to this is to decarbonise at a faster rate, so we do not have a dependency on oil and gas. That's the answer to this. And the failure of the UK government to recognise that is demonstrated by the way in which they continue to have transmission charges that penalise Scottish projects, making them the most expensive in the whole of the UK to take forward, causing businesses to choose to put their investments elsewhere, and also failing to take forward projects like the Scottish Cluster and carbon capture and utilisation, the best placed project in the whole of the UK to demonstrate a key form of technology that can help to deal with the energy transition but also meet our climate change targets. What we need from the UK government is a level of ambition that matches ours in decarbonising our energy system and meeting our climate change obligations.
Now, there's much interest in this question. I'd like to take those who've pressed. I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And I call Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Now, given that the SNP promised there would be 130,000 renewable jobs by 2020, but for the fourth year running, the number has fallen and sits at just over 20,000. Oil and gas workers simply don't trust the government when they talk about a just transition, as the Cabinet Secretary has just done. If the government are serious about a just transition, will the Cabinet Secretary commit to every single penny raised from the ScotWind leasing round being ring-fenced for investment directly related to opportunities created by that leasing to ensure that the vast majority of supply chain jobs are in Scotland instead of offshoring those jobs in the same way the government has offshored the profits?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Presiding Officer, two key points here. The first of those points is that it's important that as we see our reliance on oil and gas reducing, that we deliver a just transition. And that's why, as part of our refresh of the energy strategy, we're also taking forward our just transition planning to make sure that it aligns with our energy policy for the sector, to support those in the oil and gas sector to move into a renewable energy sector as well. And the second point I would make to the member, in terms of the revenues which are generated by ScotWind, as has been set out from the options funding payments that will be made by those who have been giving leasing options, is that we will use that money to prioritise our investment in tackling climate change and also tackling biodiversity loss, the two twin crises that we face as part of the global challenge. And we'll make sure that that funding is used in a way that actually helps to deliver jobs and also to protect our natural environment and tackle climate change. So I can give the member an assurance that this government is absolutely determined to make sure that we capitalise on not just the environmental but also the economic benefits of ScotWind to deliver a just transition for the oil and gas sector in Scotland, but also to protect and enhance our natural environment for the years to come.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Minister, we know that Russia's invasion of Ukraine could result in a significant increase in energy bills, which will be a huge concern to many households across Scotland already facing a cost of living crisis. Given the energy reserve, will the Scottish Government continue to push the UK Government to cut VAT on energy bills, which would be one of the most simple means of helping energy consumers in the short term?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, we have now raised this issue with the UK Government on a number of occasions that they need to take seriously the whole cost of living crisis that households are facing. It is going to result in a significant number of people in Scotland ending up in fuel poverty and in extreme fuel poverty. And as we can now see, the measures that have been taken forward by the UK Government are to some degree, let's say, nothing more than smoke and mirrors. Even the £150 that people were meant to get as a discount on their council tax payment, turns out there is no new money from the UK Government to support that. This is an issue which the UK Government, I think, have failed to recognise is going to blow up in their face at some point in the future, because households are facing extreme financial challenge now, particularly those in lower incomes. And it's time for the UK Government to face up to that and to put serious financial resources in place to support households who are experiencing those difficulties. It could be removing VAT on fuel bills. It could be about providing new money to help to meet the cost of living crisis. And it could also involve making sure that the loans that they are providing to people over the course of this year is actually converted into a grant in order to support them, rather than playing out a game that is nothing more than smoke and mirrors when families are struggling to actually decide on whether they can heat their homes or put food on the table.
Mark Ruskell.
Across Europe, governments are waking up to the fact that we must end our dependency on oil and gas in order to create a safe and secure world. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the UK Tory government needs to urgently invest in renewables and insulation, instead of listening to the likes of Liam Kerr and Nigel Farage, who would rather plunge households into poverty by locking us into a future of volatile gas prices and climate breakdown?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Liam Kerr and Nigel Farage are joined at the hip, clearly, when it comes to energy policy. Mr. Ruskell, I don't know if Liam Kerr would entirely agree with that. However, let me say this. What I think is extremely important here is that we need to make sure that that we don't lose sight of the climate crisis which we face. We only have to reflect upon the report that was published by the IPCC just over a week ago, demonstrating not just the extent to which climate change is already locked into our society, greater and more damaging than was previously thought, also that we are at risk of not meeting our climate change obligations because of the lack of action that's been taken on an international basis. It was described, the report was described as being called an atlas of human suffering for good reason. Climate change threatens human well-being, billions are vulnerable, and some impacts are already here. Extreme weather. The 1.5 degrees target is important to prevent even worse. Not my words, but the words of Maurice Golden just last week when he described the report. What we need is some honesty from the Conservative Party about the need to take the action that's necessary to tackle climate change rather than playing petty politics on issues that they fail to bring forward substantial answers on.
And Beatrice Wishart.
Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise the importance of the thousands of onshore jobs in the Scottish supply chain supporting North Sea oil and gas, and that their transferable skills are critical to the innovation and development of renewables?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I think the member raises an important point, because our oil and gas sector is a strength to our renewable sector in Scotland as part of our energy transition. We can see from the assessment work that's already been carried out in the oil and gas sector is that many of those who have skills in oil and gas have skills which are highly transferable to new low-carbon energy systems and into the renewable energy sector. And what we need to do is to make sure that we capitalise on that, and that's why, as part of our new energy strategy, we'll also be taking forward the just transition planning for the energy sector to make sure we're delivering the type of support and assistance to assist those in our oil and gas sector to transfer into the new low-carbon energies of the future.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.